A very good evening. My name is Samuel Labo, and today we are going to talk about a very interesting topic which is there in our fifth semester food production syllabus. And the name of the topic is Uses of Herbs and Wine in Cooking. So in this session, we'll be talking about herbs, we'll be classifying them, we'll be talking about the points to be considered when you select different types of herbs. We'll also be going ahead and talking about how to store them properly. And finally, we'll talk about how to use them in cooking. Moving forward, we'll also be talking about wines. We'll try to classify them. We'll talk about the uses of wine in cooking. We'll also talk about the points to be considered when you select wines for cooking. And finally, a simple parameter or a guideline for pairing wine with food. So let's get started. Botanically speaking, most of the plants can be classified under three broad categories: herbs, shrubs, and trees. So if you're talking about herbs, they are the small plants having a soft and a delicate stem, and they grow just above the ground. Moving on, we have shrubs, which are medium-sized plants. They branch near the ground, and they have a thin but a woody stem. And finally, we have trees, which are very tall and big plants, which branch much above the ground, and they have a thick stem, and we call them the trunk. So simply speaking, today we'll be focusing more on the herbs, and just putting it in one line, if you talk about herbs, we can say that herbs generally refer to the leafy green or the flowering parts of a plant. Now the question arises, why do we need to use those, okay? Why are herbs such a favorite in the culinary world? So yes, herbs are highly aromatic, which makes it one of the most important reasons for selecting herbs in cooking. Along with the aroma, herbs also impart a very subtle and a wonderful flavor to the dish with which it's been cooked with. And moving on, if you're talking about food, food should always be presented in a very neat, balanced, and attractive manner. And this is the point of time where herbs just add a different dimension to plate presentation. And when it comes to nutritive values and medicinal properties, herbs just hit the right chord there, because we all know that herbs are packed with different types of vitamins and different types of minerals, like vitamins A, C, K. We've talked about minerals, you name it, iron, calcium, phosphorus, magnesium, zinc, and it's all there. And this is the point of time where we come across this word called the herbalist, and who are specialized, or they are the specialists, and they specialize in the study of the medicinal qualities of herbs. Now, if we talk about classifying herbs, herbs can be classified as culinary herbs, medicinal herbs. We can have aromatic herbs, as well as we can have ornamental herbs. But we're not going to go too much in details, making the whole session very long and a bit boring for all of you. So we'll try to keep it very short and simple, and we'll just have two basic categories, okay? So first one are the fresh herbs, and the second one that we have are the dried herbs. So once you have the concept of herbs being used in the kitchen, we all know that at some point of time, we need to go and purchase them. Or if you're working in a hotel, we need to be there in the receiving department of the particular kitchen. And we have responsibilities of receiving them when the supplier supplies it to you. So one of the things that needs to be kept in mind when you talk about selecting herbs, okay, and specifically the fresh herbs. So let's go one by one. Receive them in proper bunches. So when you receive herbs in proper bunches, what happens is it keeps for a longer period of time. When you take those herbs, the fresh herbs, when it comes to you, it should always have a fresh aroma. Okay, it should be highly aromatic. Leaves should be bright and crisp, and make sure that there are no holes on those leaves, which is a sign of insect infestation, and we do not want to use those kind of herbs in our kitchen. Moving on. As much as possible, depending upon the kind of herb that you are receiving, try to have those roots much intact to that particular plant, and make sure that they are clean, as in not much of mud and impurities added to it. The stems should be firm yet tender and moist when broken. And one very important point here is make sure that there are no rubber bands, stapler pins, dirty plastics or newspapers being wrapped along with that particular herb, because you don't want all of these impurities coming inside your kitchen. Because it is because of these things we have a lot of food contamination and food complaints. And these rubber bands or stapler pins yields or results in a lot of physical contamination in the kitchen. So if you don't want much of food complaints, and trust me, when you go to a customer for all these kind of careless mistakes that we actually do in our kitchen, it's not at all a good feeling. So now if you have extra fresh herbs in your kitchen and you want to rather store them for next day's use and you don't want to throw them in the dustbin, so what are the things that can be done to preserve those herbs? There are many ways of doing it, but we'll be talking about the three most common ones. Okay, so if you have extra fresh herbs, first thing that can be done is drying them, next is freezing them, and the third one is mixing them with butter. So let's go one by one. If you're talking about drying, okay, our idea here is to evaporate or dehydrate that particular herb, as in to remove the moisture of the water content, and not the flavorful volatile oils, okay? So try not to expose it to heat. It's a very simple procedure where we can just tie it up and hang it upside down and leave it in a well-ventilated, a cool, dark place, and then leave it for around a week or two. And once those herbs have dried naturally, you can then transfer them in an airtight container and then store it in a cool, dry place. Secondly, we talk about freezing, where the herb that you have in hand can be placed in those ice cube boxes along with some water in it, and then you freeze them. Or you can also churn them in a mixer grinder, pour the puree in those ice cube boxes, you freeze them, and as and when you need it, you can just take it out and then use it in your soup, sauces, or whatever you're preparing it with. And the third one that we have here is mixing with butter. Here comes the concept of compound butter or a bio compose, which is basically mixing the extra herbs that you have in hand, finely chopping them, and then mixing it with softened butter. And then you put it in the refrigerator, and as and when you need it, you can just take a dollop of it and cook it, use it for grilling, frying, whatever at that point of time the kitchen demands. Now, once we have done with the selection criteria or things to be considered while selecting of fresh herbs, let's move on to selection criteria of dry herbs. Because obviously, it will not be possible for all of us to dry enough herb in our kitchen for the whole hotel to use. Okay, so we need to depend on certain companies or suppliers who will be supplying some good quality dry herbs to our hotel. So there are certain things that needs to be kept in mind whenever we are receiving those goods, or when you go for a store pickup. Certain things that needs to be checked when you receive those dry herbs in the kitchen. First of all, receive it in proper airtight packaging. Okay, so it needs to be airtight. Check for the expiry date or the best before date. That is a very important point, because we are actually getting sourcing all of these ingredients from the companies, and each and every product has its own best before date and expiry date. So it's a wise thing to check those before you actually get it in the kitchen. Moving on, check for tampering or damages. We don't want the containers where the dry herbs are being supplied to be broken or chipped, as we don't want the pieces of glasses or plastics to be found in the food that you're serving to the guest. So again, a sign of physical contamination, and again, you don't want to go to the guest for all these kind of silly mistakes. And make sure that the containers are properly sealed. And finally, to be on a safer side, try to use reputed brands. Now let's talk about how to store herbs, okay? Once we know how to select herbs, fresh and dry, now let's talk about how to actually store them. And we'll start off by talking about the fresh herbs first. So if you have fresh herbs that you want to store for the next day's work, what we can do is we can dry it thoroughly before you store it. So obviously we wash those herbs before we use it, but make sure that you dry it thoroughly before you store it. Next is always arrange it neatly. Okay, when I talk about arranging it neatly, what we actually mean here is getting those roots on one side and those leaves on one side, arranging it neatly before you actually put it in the refrigerator or a walk-in cooler for storage. Next thing is If you have fresh herbs, there are two ways of storing them, okay? The first way is by immersing the root of the particular plant or the herb in a container with some water, and then covering it with a cling film lightly, and then you can place it in a cool and dark place or in a refrigerator. And the second way of doing it is by wrapping those neatly arranged dried herbs on a kitchen towel. Then you roll it up, wrap it, and then maybe you can put it in a food grade plastic packet with some perforation inside it, and then place it in the refrigerator. Now make sure that you don't place it in a refrigerator or a walk-in cooler that is freezing, okay? We're looking for a temperature of around 1 degree to 5 degrees centigrade. That should be fine. So yes, a plastic bag, and make sure that that's a food grade plastic material that you're using in the kitchen. And one very simple, yet some of the time we actually oversee this particular point. Whenever you're storing fresh herbs, make sure that you don't put any kind of other heavy vegetables or other objects or utensils on it. Okay, so if you have a rack dedicated only for fresh herbs, that would be the best option here. Now let's talk about how to store dry herbs, okay? We have paid a good amount of money purchasing them from the market. Now let's talk about how to store them. First rule, never refrigerate dry herbs, okay? If you want your dry herbs to remain dry, do not refrigerate, because once you refrigerate that particular dry herb, and when you take it out from the refrigerator, inevitably there'll be condensation happening, and we don't want your herbs to get moist, and obviously it will get spoiled very fast. Try to keep your cupboards or your dry store cupboard neat and tidy, and obviously free from any kind of pests or rodents. Always follow this FEFO, which stands for first expired, first out. So when you have it in your dry store, always arrange all of those dry herbs or other bottled products depending upon the expiry date of that particular commodity. So you want to use those ingredients which are going to expire first. That way, obviously, we'll be saving a lot of cost, and we will refrain from throwing things in the dustbin. And if you're talking about being a chef, it's not only about cooking delicious food and doing awesome food plating, you know, because at the end of the day, it all boils down to generating revenue and profit for the company. Okay, so we need to keep our food cost in check, and these small things will help us understand how to get all of these things assimilated and obviously training our team to work as a team to achieve this particular goal. Moving on, yes, dry herbs, if you're talking about dry herbs, always store it in a cool and dark place, like we discussed, in an airtight container, and always away from moisture. Now let us go into the next phase, that is, we are talking about the culinary uses of herbs, okay? So why actually, or in how many ways that we can use herbs in cooking? Okay, so we'll go point by point. And the first thing that we're going to talk about is as a flavoring agent or an ingredient. So herbs are highly aromatic, and we also know that it is highly flavorful when you add it in different types of soups, sauces, any kind of food you talk about, okay? So if you talk about soups, you name it, you know, you talk about a consomme, you talk about different varieties of broths, you talk about puree, crème, bisque, chowder, you name it, and in each and every soup that we actually work with, we use some kind of a herb in some form or the other to get that subtle, wonderful flavor out of that particular herb, and ultimately elevating the flavor of the overall dish. Next, you talk about different varieties of sauces. Yes, we use them. You talk about different varieties of curries. Yes, definitely. In our own Indian context, you talk about bay leaf. You talk about that simple coriander leaf. When you place it as a garnish or when you add it in that particular food, when you cook it, it just makes that food taste delicious. Next thing that we have here is obviously talking about different varieties of herbs that can also be used in different varieties of force meat. My personal favorite, talk about different types of sausages, salami, galantine, balutine, pape, terrine, you name it. So in all those different types of force meat that we can talk about, we use different types of herbs to flavor them. Next, obviously, to flavor different varieties of stock, And stock, as we all know, is the basic foundation liquid that we use in the kitchen, and also known as the fond de cuisine. And yes, if you want to have a delicious soup or a sauce or a stew, we need a good flavorful stock. And this is a point of time where we use different types of herbs to flavor the stock and to make it a bit more appetizing and delicious. Now in stock, we have this particular word that is known as a bouquet garni, or in French we call it sachet de piece, which is basically a small bundle which is made of aromatic herbs like parsley, thyme, leek and bay leaf. We tie it into a small sachet and we dip it in that particular liquid that is being used to prepare stock. And once the flavor of those herbs has been infused in the stock, we remove it and we throw it. And then we use the particular stock for different other preparations. We also use herbs in bakery, where we talk about flavoring different varieties of cakes, gâteaux, we talk about ganache, talk about different types of breads, cookies, you name it, we definitely use them. As well as we also use herbs to flavor different varieties of cheese. If you're working in the garde manger, you can find these flavored cheese being used as a spread in different other food platings, or rather the buffet that you have in the coffee shop. So after flavoring, herbs can also be used for garnishing, where we come to a concept where food should not only taste good, but on the other hand should also look very neat and attractive. And there we have this particular concept of a new Nordic style of food plating, where less is more, and garnishing plays a very important role there. So if we're talking about herbs being used as a garnish, it can be used as a whole or chopped. Now let's talk about certain herbs, or certain ways in which herbs can be used for garnishing. Okay, so the first example that we have here is of a fin herb, which is basically a herb mixture used in French cuisine. It's basically a fine mixture of finely chopped parsley, tarragon, chervil and chives, which are used as a garnish for different dishes, as well as used to make or flavor different types of sauces, and also used to make different types of omelets. My personal favorite. Apart from using a fin herb, we can also find herbs being deep fat fried and then used as a garnish. Okay, if you talk about herbs like parsley, basil, curry leaves, rosemary, okay, these can be deep fat fried and then used as a garnish. But things to be kept in mind when you are working with herbs to be fried: first thing is, make sure that the herb that you're working with is absolutely dry. We don't want excess moisture or water in that particular herb, for obvious reasons, because you're going to put it in hot oil, and if there's a lot of water in that particular herb, there'll be a lot of accidents in the kitchen, which we do not want. So make sure it's dried, and don't put it in a very hot oil. The idea is not to burn those herbs, but the idea here is to get a nice crisp and very flavorful, and a herb that is retaining its natural color. Okay, so try not to fry it in very hot oil. A medium hot oil would do the purpose, or rather serve the purpose. We use different types of herbs like parsley, basil, thyme, rosemary, and different other type of herbs are also used. But the thing that needs to be kept in mind is that always soak it in cold water. Okay, you need to soak in cold water till it's further used in the food plating part. So what happens is, in the hotel, we normally have a garnishing tray or a box where we have different compartments, and we place some cold water in it, and we place those herbs in those compartments. So once the food has been cooked, assembled, before we put it on the hot plate, pickup counter, what we do is, we do the last minute garnishing with those fresh herbs, okay, where we use the sprigs of those herbs, and obviously keeping in mind that we use those herbs that will complement the flavor of the dish. So that is one very popular way of using fresh herbs as a sprig. Moving on, herbs can also be used to make different types of seasonings. And as we can see, the first example that we have here is of a saltless seasoning. And as the name suggests, this kind of seasoning is usually for those people who are a bit health conscious and they want to refrain from excessive consumption of sodium in their diet. So we have this mixture of different types of flavorful herbs like dill, thyme, oregano, combined with other aromatic ingredients like dried onion powder, sesame seeds, black pepper, dried lemon peel, paprika, garlic powder, which can be drizzled or served as a condiment when you're serving certain kinds of dishes to the guest. Here I'm reminded of my personal favorite, that is my pizza. So whenever I order this pizza, and I always remember asking for those extra dry herbs that I can sprinkle on those pizza along with some chili flakes and then enjoying or relishing it. And so this is one particular way where saltless seasonings can be used. And moving on, we have the other part, which is the herbal salts, which is simply where we have salt that has been flavored with different types of dry herbs. Okay, so we have rock salt and herbs churned together and kept in the kitchen, and you can use it as and when you need it. And the most common one that we have here is the celery salt, the rosemary salt. You can actually make your own mix, okay, depending upon the kind of flavor that you want to impart in that particular dish. You can make your own mix and your own herbal salts. Next, herbs are also used to make herbal oils, okay. And we're talking about herbal oil in the culinary world, where these herbal oils are used as a salad dressing, can be used for marinating your protein or different other ingredients, and obviously can also be used for different food plating. So I'll be talking about this particular part, and I'll be showing you some certain pictures that we actually clicked during our practical classes where we use this concept of herbal oil in food plating. And so if you talk about this herbal oil, it can be made with any kind of herb that you want to choose. And there are two basic ways of preparing them. First is you immerse this herb in warm oil and then let it infuse for a week. And finally, you strain it and decant it, and then you use it. And the other one that is more popular is by infusing those herbs, or rather the leaves of those herbs, in warm oil. You leave it for an hour or so, and then you blend it in the mixer grinder. Then you strain them, and then you bottle it, and then you use it for food presentation or even as a flavoring for different types of salads or marinades. Yes, herbs can also be used to flavor different types of vinegars and wines. And obviously, if you're using those flavorful vinegars to make your marinade or to make your vinaigrette for the salad dressing, it is definitely going to elevate the flavor of the dish. You can use those flavored vinegar or wine to drizzle over roasted vegetables. It can be drizzled over your favorite basa or your Norwegian salmon that is being grilled on the hot plate. And it can also be added to soups and stews to add some extra flavor. And my personal favorite can also be added as a last minute flavoring for different types of stir-fried items. Herbs can also be used to make herbal butter, where we talk about this concept of compound butter or bio compose, which is a very simple process of mixing different types of aromatic fresh herbs with softened butter. And the two most common examples that we have here are maître d'hôtel butter, which is basically butter that is mixed with chopped parsley and lemon juice. And it is used for one of my favorite dishes, which is a chicken a la kif, where we stuff this particular butter in the chicken breast, then you crumb it, and then you deep fat fry it. And then the second one that we have here is a chive butter, which is butter that is mixed with finely chopped chives.
Okay, very good evening, everybody, and welcome back. So in the previous session, we spoke about the theoretical aspect of uses of wine and herbs in cooking. So what we're going to do right now is, using the same concept, we'll be just taking one example of it, and we'll be preparing a maître de butter, or rather, which comes under the category of herb butter. And we call it, the full form is maître d'hôtel butter, or pure maître d'hôtel. And so let's go about and see what are the ingredients that we'll be needing for this particular herb butter. So for this particular herb butter, first of all, we'll be taking some salted butter. I'm using salted butter here. So we have softened it and creamed it. Next ingredient that we'll be using would be some freshly chopped English parsley. And please remember that whenever you chop this English parsley, as we know that these are very tender herbs, So make sure you use a very sharp knife and do not bruise it so that you can keep it for a longer period of time. And along with the English parsley or the curled parsley, we'll be using some lemon wedges. And finally, we have some seasonings, that is salt and crushed white pepper powder. So it's always a good idea to get some white pepper corns in your kitchen, broil it up, and then you make a powder out of it. Okay, now let's go about assembling all of these ingredients to make this herb butter. So we'll take the butter first. To it, we'll be adding some chopped parsley. Season it with a little bit of, as I'm using salted butter, so I'll be a bit careful with the amount of salt that I'll be adding to this butter. A bit of crushed white pepper powder. Once I've added all of these ingredients, give it a nice mix. So you can make this butter whenever you want to actually, if you're planning to serve some roast meat or grilled fish for your dinner, or if you're working in a hotel, if you have it in the menu and it's a weekend where you are expecting or anticipating a lot of guests to come to your hotel, you can make a good quantity of it, make it into small batches, roll it up and put it in the refrigerator so that you can use it as and when required. Because the idea is not to start preparing this particular butter when the order comes in, so we need to get it ready, keep it in hand, and once the food is ready, we just take it out and then slice it and place it on the grilled meat or the fish that we're going to use. Okay, so once we've added the chopped parsley, salt, pepper, we're going to add the lemon juice to this particular butter. I'm going to lightly mix it. Okay, so what now we need to get a piece of greaseproof paper or a parchment paper ready, and I have cut it 6 inches to 8 inches in dimension. So now we'll be adding it in this particular piece of paper, and then we'll be rolling it into a cylindrical shape so that we can store it conveniently in the refrigerator as well as portion it up properly when you're actually serving it with your mains or your protein. So what we're going to do is we'll just put it on the greaseproof paper. Okay. Next is rolling it. So when you're rolling it, roll it up, and you can use a scraper or your knife to give it a nice cylindrical shape. So depending upon the standard of your restaurant or the a la carte portioning of that particular restaurant, you can have a larger cylindrical shape or a smaller one. Next is neatly rolling it up, and once you've rolled it, you need to seal this particular piece of paper from both the sides. So I'm going to lightly first of all seal it from both the sides, and then gradually twist it to get a nice cylindrical shape. Okay, now to add on to this particular thing, we can also cling wrap it, because we know that butter is a very delicate commodity in the kitchen, and it has a tendency to absorb any kind of aroma that you might be having in the particular refrigerator. So it's a good idea that if you're using that particular walk-in or your refrigerator for storing mushrooms or different types of sauces, it's a good idea to cling wrap it and then store it in the refrigerator. So we'll leave it in the refrigerator for it to set, and once it's set, we'll take it out, we'll slice it up, and then we'll show you how to use it further. So after around 15 minutes, once you have set this particular Bure Matre d'Hotel in your refrigerator, it's out from the refrigerator, and now we're gonna unwrap it and see how it goes. So be careful when you're unwrapping it so that you don't leave any pieces of paper or the cling wrap on the butter because, as we already discussed, if you're talking about physical contamination in the kitchen, these are the ways how food gets contaminated, or rather you get more and more of guest complaints, okay? So please be a bit careful when you're working with any kind of thing that is coming out of the refrigerator, especially that has been packed or wrapped. Okay, so once you get this particular butter ready, and in case the grilled meat is ready or your proteins are ready to be plated, so just before you send it out of the restaurant, and suppose you have a beef steak, so along with the beef steak, the accompanying jus, the mashed potatoes and all the garnishes are almost ready. And then when you're assembling all of these things, we can have a slice of this particular Bure Matre d'Hotel butter placed on top of it and then send out to the restaurant. So I'll be just slicing it here and placing it in the... So I'll be just placing some of these pieces of butter in a bowl, which can be used to be placed as a source of moisture for your grilled meat or fish, as well as can be used as a spread for your canapes or for different types of sandwiches that you might be working out with. And more onto this, you can even use your own innovative ideas to add more of herbs or different types of aromatic ingredients like garlic, a bit of chopped garlic, to make your chicken a la kiev, which can also be used to stuff this particular piece of chicken, breaded and then deep fried. So I urge all of you to at least go ahead and try it out at home, and let's see how it goes.
Now, as we know that herbs are packed with different types of nutrients and it has a lot of medicinal properties, herbs are very much used to make different types of herbal drinks. And if you're talking about herbal drinks, yes, you talk about herbal teas, yes, we serve it in the hotel and we also like consuming it at home. We have herbal water, especially in spas and different types of other fine dining restaurants. These days you'll find the bottle of water being served with a sprig of mint leaf immersed in it, which gives that particular water a nice, fresh, refreshing taste and a flavor. Apart from that, herbs are also used for flavoring our favorite cocktails and mocktails. Herbs, moving on, can also be used to make different types of dips, spreads and marinades. We have different types of herb sauces like parsley, dill, mint, which are prepared and used as a dip or a marinade at times. Some of the examples, common examples that we can talk about here are the pesto that we have, which is flavored with basil, with other ingredients like pine nut, garlic, olive oil. And we have a contemporary part of that particular pesto that we also have a shormola, which is also a dip and a marinade that is made of, we have parsley, we have coriander, we have some broiled cumin, coriander seeds, paprika along with garlic. We have chimichurri that is also served as a dip from South America. And our own favorite, that is the mint chutney from India, which I personally love with our tandoori chicken or reshmi tikka kebab and all of those items. And I'm sure you're all enjoying it at home. Next, herbs can also be used as paste and crust. So these days we have different types of herb mixtures which are prepared and used to give a nice coating or a crust to different types of protein. So we use that herb mixture, coat it on the meat or fish, and then you pan fry it, you sear it, and then you grill it or you bake it in the oven and serve it with the accompanying jus or the other accompaniments that might follow along with the particular dish. So here we have two examples. There are two photographs up here of one of a gravlax, which is basically a Nordic dish prepared out of fresh Norwegian salmon, cured with salt and sugar, flavored with dill and black pepper. This particular dish is very similar to our Japanese sashimi, where we actually serve the salmon sashimi raw, but on the other hand, we have gravel legs that is served where the salmon is cured and then served. The other photograph that we have here is of New Zealand lamb chop that has been herb crusted, seared and baked in the oven and served with the jus.